My name is Daniel Barnett. I'm the Vice President for the American Physician Scientist Association, and today it is my great honor to introduce our speaker for the APSA Lasker Prize Award Lecture. So today, that is Dr. Douglas Lowy, who is the current acting director of the NIH National Cancer Institute. Dr. Lowy also served as NCI's acting director from 2015 to 2017, and has been helping lead NCI's key scientific initiatives as deputy director since 2010. His more than 40-year track record of cancer research surveillance, cancer research excellence, resulted in his earning the National Medal of Technology and Innovation from President Barack Obama in 2014. This was for his work that led to the development of the human papillomavirus vaccine and in turn left a tremendous positive impact on population health. Dr. Lowy received his medical degree from New York University School of Medicine. He then trained in internal medicine at Stanford University and dermatology at Yale University. As chief of the Laboratory of Cellular Oncology in the Center for Cancer Research at the NCI, Dr. Lowy's research includes the biology of papillomavirus and the regulation of normal and neoplastic growth. His laboratory, in close collaboration with Dr. John Schiller, was involved in the development, characterization, and clinical testing of the preventative virus-like particle-based HPV vaccines that are now used in 3 FDA-approved HPV vaccines. Dr. Lowy is a member of the National Academy of Sciences and the National Academy of Medicine. For their pioneering work, Lowy and Schiller received numerous honors in addition to the National Medal, including the 2017 Lasker DeBakey Clinical Medical Research Award. Today, we are extremely excited for Dr. Lowy's presentation entitled Preventing HPV-Associated Cancers by Vaccination.
Dr. Barnett, thank you so much for this wonderful introduction. I'm really pleased to be here, and I want to tell you at the outset that I really appreciate trying to highlight cancer prevention. The way I think about it is that there are no grateful patients, but the limitation is that there are no grateful patients. My disclosures are that I am an inventor of the vaccine, and the NIH has licensed the vaccine to the 2 pharmaceutical companies that manufacture the commercial versions. I will discuss potential off-label uses of the vaccine, protecting against HPV-positive oropharynx cancer, and fewer doses than currently are FDA approved. I've been an inventor of a number of other areas, but they're not directly relevant to today's presentation. I'm going to focus on 3 different issues. A short sort of primer on the epidemiology of cancers with recognized infectious etiology, and then turning to HPV-associated cancers, the vaccine development, and short-term impact from vaccination. And then some research we have conducted and continue to conduct to address scientific issues related to HPV infection and the vaccine that ultimately have an impact on wider dissemination of the vaccine. This slide depicts for you that the different infectious agents that are well recognized as major contributors to cancer. The one bacterium that is very common is H. pylori in stomach cancer, and then the various viruses with HPV causing more cancers than any other virus, but hepatitis B and C causing liver cancer, EBV, HHV-8, et cetera. The reason it has 15% to 18% of cancer worldwide is that in this review article from 3 years ago, the the role of EBV in gastric cancer was not recognized, but I think that it is really a clinical pathological entity, and about 10% of gastric cancer worldwide appears to be attributable to EBV-associated cancer. So the epidemiology and prognosis of HPV-associated cancer really depends on where you live. First, focus on the left side of this slide. In blue is depicted the incidence of cancer in different areas in the world, with the high-income countries being down on the bottom with small blue and low-income countries on the top with large blue. The red indicates the mortality rates. And what I hope you can appreciate is if you look on the bottom, the mortality rates are less than one-third in high-income countries, with the red being very small, whereas in the low-income countries, the mortality rates are well over 50%. And this is a factor because of screening in high-income countries, but currently there is no high-quality screening in any high-income country. If you now turn your attention to the right, you can see that the United States actually was a high cervical cancer incidence country in the 1950s, and over time we have become a low incidence country. This is attributable primarily to pap smear screening and follow-up. The vaccine has had no impact on this yet. If you now turn to HPV-associated cancer in the United States, it's very different in its profile from the HPV-associated cancer in the developing world. In the developing world, more than 90% of HPV-associated cancer is cervical cancer, and therefore about 95% of HPV-associated cancer in the developing world affects women. In the United States, it's more like a 60-40% split. And this is attributable mainly to two different factors. The first is that as a result of screening, cervical cancer is much less common in the United States. And the second factor is that oropharynx cancer has had a substantial increase in its incidence over the last 30 years. And most cases of oropharynx cancer that is HPV positive occurs in men. I should point out that vaccination has been reported to reduce oral HPV prevalence by about 90%. This has not led to FDA approval because these really are post-marketing studies rather than in a controlled clinical trial. The natural history of cervical cancer is uniform regardless of where women are. It starts with HPV infection, shown by this, the green line, and then there is precancer, which is with the blue line, and then eventually invasive cervical cancer with the red line. Luckily, the vast majority of women who are infected at the cervix with HPV have self-limited infection. And when the infection goes away, their increased risk of developing cervical cancer goes with it. And we have really two opportunities for intervention: primary prevention with vaccination and secondary prevention with screening. It's the women who have persistent infection who are at risk of first developing precancer and then invasive cancer. Turning to HPV vaccines, I want to acknowledge here the really strong collaboration with many people. John Schiller and I have worked together for more than 30 years, and we really are a partnership and do virtually all of this together. Reinhard Kernbauer at the University of Vienna was a postdoctoral fellow. Reinhard is a dermatologist, and he did most of the research that was for the early work on the vaccine. I also want to acknowledge Jeffrey Roberts, who currently is at the FDA, but Jeff is a gynecologist, and he developed the mouse the mouse challenge model for HPV that I will discuss in a few minutes. And I would point out that this was the only laboratory experience that Jeff had. So the key issues for HPV vaccine development are, first, there was no precedent for a successful vaccine against a local sexually transmitted infection. Protective immunity against infection is usually attributable to neutralizing antibodies, but it was not clear how to make a vaccine that would induce high levels of neutralizing antibodies. And the solution that John and I came up with was a subunit vaccine of virus-like particles, or VLPs, composed of the main protein that makes the outer shell of the virus called L1. There is also a minor capsid protein called L2, and we'll talk about that very briefly a little bit later. L1 contains the immunodominant neutralization epitopes. This slide is intended as being somewhat less funny than the slide that Dr. June showed a few minutes ago of getting out of school on Monday. But I just want you to understand that John and I had no experience in vaccines, immunology, translational research, or structural papillomavirus protein before we started doing this. But we did have experience in papillomavirus biology, and very important for us is the freedom and the collaborative spirit of the intramural NIH program. So this slide tells you basically what Reinhard did, which was to insert L1 into a baculovirus expression vector and to produce it in cells, and it spontaneously assembled into virus-like particles, 360 copies of L1. Very important, it induced high titers of virion neutralizing antibodies. Reinhard had to do the experiment three times before he diluted the serum sufficiently to get an endpoint, which was basically 1 to 10,000. The material is non-infectious and non-oncogenic. What about safety? There's been extensive safety testing by the CDC and particularly in Scandinavian areas, and I just highlight for you a recent paper mainly from the CDC saying that safety data have been reassuring with no confirmed safety signals identified. A more recent review from Australia reached similar conclusions. So, in the phase three trials of the three different HPV vaccines that have ultimately been FDA approved, if you look on the right, the efficacy for pre-cancer at the cervix for all three vaccines was over 95%. This is in women who had no genital HPV infection detected at the beginning of the trial. This group is most comparable to the target group for which the vaccine is destined, which is young adolescents who have not yet become sexually active and are HPV negative at that time. Genital warts also are highly protected, and from a mechanistic point of view, that is interesting because it indicates that there must be some kind of liberation of the antibodies into the skin, and I'll have something to say about that in a few minutes. It's the first successful vaccine against a local sexually transmitted infection, and 3 years ago, the 9-valent vaccine was approved for 2 doses in young adolescents. What are the goals of HPV vaccination? Really twofold. First, in the vaccinees, to directly reduce the risk of infection and disease in them. but second, to indirectly reduce risk by reducing prevalence of the HPV vaccine types in the general population or herd immunity. Certainly, measles has been in the news the last couple of years because of decreasing herd immunity in the United States. We are not yet at that point with the HPV vaccine. I'm going to show you two pieces of data from Australia, which were early adopters of the vaccine. The vaccine was FDA approved and worldwide in 2006. Australia started its vaccination program in 2007. The government bought the vaccine, and it was provided free of charge to women, but only women who were of the appropriate age, which was essentially 12 to 26, and they used the Merck vaccine, which is a quadrivalent vaccine, using HPV 16 and 18 as the basis, and about 70% of cervical cancer is attributable to infection with 16 and 18, and probably over 90% of the non-cervical cancers are attributable to HPV 16 and 18. If you look on the left, this shows that there was a rapid decrease in the incidence of cervical precancers in the young women. The reason that these women were screened is that at the time, Australia still did screening in rather young women. They've increased the age, and we in the United States don't start screening until women are 21. But if you look on the right, you'll see that the women who were too old to be eligible for vaccination, there's no change in their precancer. This, I think, is an even more remarkable slide because it shows the decreased incidence in genital warts in heterosexual Australian men following vaccine implementation of just women. Only women got the vaccine. Remember, this is the quadrivalent vaccine, or Gardasil, and it contains virus-like particles against HPV 6 and 11 in addition to 16 and 18. And 6 and 11 together are responsible for about 90% of genital warts. If you look at the blue line that goes down furthest, this is the dramatic decrease in genital warts among men within 3 years of introduction of the vaccine. And I just will remind you that only women were vaccinated. By contrast, the interrupted green line shows you heterosexual men over 30 who presumably had much less interaction with these younger women. No change in their incidence of genital warts, at least not statistically significant. And heterosexual men 21 to 30, intermediate, statistically very significant, but not as dramatic a decrease as in the men who were under 21. I'm not going to show you all the detailed data for vaccine uptake in the United States, but what I'm doing instead is to show you, if you'll first look on the right, the incidence of HPV-associated cancers. In the dark blue are the areas that have the highest incidence of HPV-associated cancer, the Southeast and adjacent states. On the left is the current percentage of adolescents who are up to date on HPV vaccination. And the first thing that you'll note is it's very heterogeneous. And the second is that the darker blues represent higher vaccine rate, and the lighter ones represent less vaccination. And the less vaccination is unfortunately centered in the area where there's the highest incidence of HPV-associated cancer. So there's still a lot of work to do. About every year, about 5% more of eligible boys and girls between the ages of 13 and 17 get vaccinated. But we're still at about 50% having the full recommended dosage, which is two doses for adolescents under 15 and three doses for those who are older. So I just want to give you one kind of problem that we solved with doing laboratory-based work, because I don't want to just tell you about public health issues. John and I are really experimental scientists. So the problem was that there was no tractable experimental animal model for genital HPV infection. And we thought it was important because, first, we could study the mechanisms of HPV infection, and second, we could try to understand protection induced by vaccination. And there's a really serious problem, which is that HPV is not infectious for animals. And our solution was to use high-titer HPV pseudoviruses, which I will show you in the next slide schematically, to develop a mouse genital tract HPV challenge model. And it turns out that resistance of animals to HPV infection lies downstream from the initial infectious process. And the pseudoviruses efficiently carry out the upstream steps of this process. The animal model, as I mentioned, was developed by Jeff Roberts, and he had no prior research experience. So first, what are pseudoviruses? Pseudoviruses encode the normal capsid, the authentic capsid of the virus, that is L1 plus L2, shown on the left. But instead of encapsidating the viral genome, they encapsidate a reporter genome, and you can use whatever gene you want. And Chris Buck in the laboratory optimize this so that the papillomavirus pseudoviruses were, the titer was about a million-fold higher than previous pseudoviruses, and it enabled us to do many different experiments, and I'm just showing you one of the things that that were done with the pseudoviruses. And this was to develop this mouse challenge model. What you pre-treat the mouse the mouse with progesterone to thin the mucosa, and then you need to disrupt the intact mucosa if you are going to infect the animal, and then that's followed simply by instilling the pseudovirus at a later time. The physical disruption is just using a very small cider brush, analogous to what women have when they're having a pap smear or something like that. The chemical disruption is to use nonoxinol 9 at the same concentration as is used as spermicides in over-the-counter medication. And you can monitor the infection either by luciferase, or if you're encoding red fluorescent protein, you actually see that it's the epithelial cells that are getting infected. So I'll just show you a couple of pieces of information. First, the intact cervix is not infectable, and you need to do this in this instance with the cytobrush in order to get the infection. But if you immunize the animal with HPV-16 VLPs, you totally block the infection when you challenge with HPV-16 virus pseudoviruses. And in other experiments, there's partial protection against HPV-31 and no protection against HPV-58, entirely analogous to what has been seen in women with the FDA-approved vaccines. So how do we think things are working? If you look down on the bottom, these Ys of different kind actually represent antibodies, and there are high levels of tissue antibodies in the immunized genital tract, but in the dermis. And then up above in the intact mucosa, very low levels. In order to get infection, you need to disrupt the epithelial integrity. This exposes the basement membrane, and importantly for protection, the tissue resident antibodies go into this potential area of infection so that when the virus comes in, the antibodies bind to the virus and they prevent the binding to the basement membrane. One of the things we learned was that the first step in the virus life cycle is binding to the basement membrane, and then the virus undergoes enzymatically dependent conformational change, and then goes to the target epithelial cell. So the last area I want to discuss is the global challenge of increasing vaccine uptake in low and middle income countries. This slide is somewhat difficult to initially understand, but in green is shown the number of eligible women that there are in high income countries on the left, then upper middle income, lower middle income, and then low income as we go from left to right. In yellow is shown the girls 10 to 14 who have received the full course of HPV vaccination, and in red, girls who have only received one dose. And what I hope you can appreciate is when you look at the low middle income and low income, almost no one has been vaccinated. Almost all of the vaccination is in the higher income countries. So the good news, if you look on the top, is more than 100 million girls have received at least one dose. But the bad news is less than 5% of eligible girls in low and middle income countries have been vaccinated. And that's where the main public health problem of cervical cancer and HPV-associated cancer lie. So we are very interested in trying to see whether a single vaccine dose can induce long-term protection, because with the current efforts, it really is expensive and logistically complicated. Fortunately for us, the NCI conducted a clinical trial in Costa Rica of the bivalent vaccine, that is the GlaxoSmithKline vaccine, and what we found was that either one, two, or three doses of the vaccine confer at least 7 years of protection against incident HPV 16 and 18 infection. But this is post hoc analysis. It's not sufficient to change standard of care. If you look at the blue and the blue is HPV 16 and 18, on the right is control, and to the left are one dose, two doses, and three doses. And you can appreciate that one dose, two doses, and three doses, the blue and the red are much lower. The red is the cross protection that's seen with the bivalent vaccine. In green are the other HPV types not protected, and it looks like they're really pretty similar between the different groups, implying that sexual exposure and exposure to HPV has really been pretty similar among them. The really surprising finding is the persistent antibody levels in the women who have only gotten one dose. If you look at the dotted line, the red represents 7 years of serum antibody levels with one dose against HPV 16, and the blue represents one dose of HPV 18. If you look at the black on the bottom, those are the antibody levels that are seen with natural infection. So this is a semi-log plot. So the levels of antibody from just one dose are almost 10 times higher than the levels of antibody in women who have prevalent infection, but without getting the vaccine. Needless to say, three doses better than one. But we think that that the post hoc analysis suggests that there will be protection from one dose. The reason that we think this happens is that the signaling complexes of the immune system are really have been selected for responding to the repetitive structure of the virus-like particles, and this then leads to strong survival and proliferation signals, high levels of antibody of long duration. If you compare that on the right with the analogous situation with, say, tetanus toxoid, where you need to be vaccinated repeatedly every few years, under those circumstances, these are monomeric protein complexes, weak activation signal, low levels of antibodies, and so of shorter duration. So we've started a randomized controlled trial in Costa Rica about 15 months ago to test the efficacy of one dose versus two doses. And it's a four-arm trial where we're using the bivalent vaccine or cervarix for one and two doses, and the second generation Merck vaccine, Gardasil 9, also one and two doses. Because it's a non-inferiority trial design, we need a lot of young women in each arm in order to be able to have sufficient power to try to look at the protection. And we've completed about 50% of the enrollment, and it's a four-year primary trial, longer-term follow-up. At clinicaltrials.gov, it's available. I can assure you there are somewhat fewer HPV vaccine trials at clinicaltrials.gov than there are of CAR T-cell trials. And Amy Kramer did a review about that. So the potential impact of demonstrating one dose could confer strong protection is it could change standard of care in the United States and globally. It could save the United States more than $300 million each year in vaccine costs. But more importantly, I think it could make it feasible to control the worldwide public health problem of cervical cancer and other HPV-associated cancers. So let me summarize. What are the three big take-home lessons? The first is basic research led to identification of HPV as the cause of several cancers. Harald Zurhausen got the Nobel Prize for that in 2008. And then it led to the development of the virus-like particle technology for the vaccines. We think that this was just the beginning of the vaccine-related research, as I've shown you. There's really a lot that even remains to be done. We think the durable antibody responses to a single vaccine dose are probably attributable to the repetitive structure of the virus-like particles. And the success of the HPV vaccine has led to a number of candidate vaccines that are based either on virus-like particles or other repetitive structure, such as ferritin for candidate pandemic flu or EBV vaccines. Last, control of HPV-associated cancer as a worldwide public health problem may soon be feasible. Thank you so much for allowing me to present this.